Gonna talk about this episode. Coming to you live from Law Nation Studios. At the top of the hour, we heard news that Dak Prescott, yes, he restructured his contract to save and free up some money. Right. Also, within the confines of that, Cowboy Nation, we also hear news about the Cowboys maybe, just maybe, targeting a franchise tag on, dare I say, Dalton Schultz. Which time will tell it all on that, right? That's how all of this goes. The request for greatness is still here. Cowboy Nation, let's go. Yup. One person out, another person in. How we get this thing around? You know, that's the reality of it. Shout out to everybody that believe in the process, right? Come on. They say, really, ain't no party like a cowboy party. We all know better, right? It's Law Nation time for your mind. Right. Let's go. Yo. 5, 4, 3, 2. All right, well, my other button didn't work. It's supposed to do all of the other flashing whistles there. I need to probably create another one. But I really appreciate you guys. Let me know if you can hear me. Let me know if you guys can hear me. I really appreciate you for jumping in. Let's talk about this, the Dallas Cowboys news around the world. And I get it. I was at work, and I heard multiple people hit me up and said, hey, Law, You know, that Fisher is coming at you about this and about that. And I was like, man, bull sugar. Ain't no way. You know, old Fish. I said, ain't no way Mike Fisher would come at the Law. No. He must be out of his mind, you know. But I listened, I reviewed the video, and I said, all right, cool. All right. I see what he's coming from. And I get it. The truth is the hardest pill to swallow. It is. And there's no necessary beef between me and a beat writer, a journalist, or a person who speak to the Jones family. I don't give a two flines or whatever or what's going on with that. But I get it. People looking for somebody to point the finger at. And it is what it is at this point, but I'm going to tell you guys right now, the truth is the hardest pill to swallow, and Law Nation don't dodge nothing, right? Especially if anybody got anything to say about me. It ain't far and few and hard to find Law, right? I'm everywhere. But this is the situation. Amari Cooper, the way the news is being reported coming out of the Dallas Cowboys camp. Whether or not you guys believe me or what I say, or whether or not you guys believe or what anybody else have to say about this, this been going on how the Cowboys handle and operate their business for many of years. For a long time, the Cowboys been handling situations like this. That's just how it is. And I tell people all the time, the dog, they get hit with the brick, yelps. And that's the reality of it. I'm not over here saying that Amari Cooper is faultless with his approach to the game, nor am I sitting here saying that Amari Cooper can walk on water. No. So for anybody that believes that there's beef between me and somebody that write articles for a living, that's crazy.
Shame. Shame. Shame.
Because that's not the case nor the scenario. Hit me up with this information, Cowboy Nation, is that somebody said that insider noise said that this guy, Amari Cooper, gave lack of effort in this final game. We did the video. I said it's a smear campaign for any news to leak out with the Cowboys about Amari Cooper, knowing that this man is going through a contract flows of indifference with the Cowboys. The problem is when the news is being sullied and denigrated, the amount of information that's given out saying that this guy didn't give effort, pointing the finger. You know the craziest thing about when you point the finger, you got three pointing back at you, right? Somebody point the finger, you got three pointing back at you. And the problem is that Ray Charles can see this.
What the truth? You can't handle the truth.
But this is the thing, Cowboy Nation. Here's the situation. We know that the offense been vanilla. We know that Dak Prescott been missing some throws, right? And we know for sure that the target conversational piece been hit and missed around about the Cowboys news and organization for not just a short time, but for a long time. It's been hit. Let me go back. Y'all want to see that touchdown. Let's watch this touchdown right here. Let me just go back right here. Let's go watch this touchdown right here. Yeah, yeah. It's been hit for a long time. Targets. And what old folks say, not everybody is lying. Not everybody's lying. Look at that. Touchdown. Not everybody is lying. So there's truth into this thing. But quite frankly, here's the thing that all of the people, the journalists, and all of the people that's out here spitting rhetoric about information. Let one of the amazing people of all time, let Denzel Washington say it for me. You know, I just love the I wish I had my button. He ain't lying. You know. So everybody want to be first. Everybody want to have a detail in hand. Everybody want to say they faultless without giving up too much information. You know the ideal of this channel and the reason why I can spit my mind? Because I'm independent and I answer to nobody. There's no muffler on my mouth. No man on this planet can hush me. I'm a free-spirited guy. Counsel me all you want. Break me down, I'll build myself back up again. I'm law. And those are facts. So if anybody else have anything else to say about that, we laughing, baby. You know what I'm saying? It don't stop at law over here, baby. You know, but this is the thing. Like I said, the dog, they get hit with the brick. Yep. And the truth is the hardest pill to swallow. The truth. Because all of a sudden, Law, do you have any information on this? Law, do you have any recollection of what you're saying? There's a storyline. Me and West Coast was out there in Oxnard. Before we hit the gates, somebody's been, hey, Coop went down. We saw it on our eyes being lifted up and put on a gurney almost. This way back in 2000, I believe, or 19. And we go out there and say it. Me and West Coast. The truth. And less than 5 minutes later, oh, that's not what really happened, you know. I think it was 18. It could have been 18. No, it was 19 season. Yeah, we was out there. I'm telling people, validation is only good for parking. And Jerry Jones, as much as we all know Jerry Jones, you go wrong with him, he gonna make sure you feel it. Because the craziest thing of this all, Cowboy Nation, We've been hearing the same thing, and like I said, not everybody is lying. Boss Cowboy says, look. King Law witnessed the power of independence. You know, my guy, Boss Cowboy, he put this out before anybody had the nerve to write anything, before the whispers hit the eardrums of everybody painting the narrative. Boss Cowboy says Cooper will be attacked by Dallas local media this offseason, but the real problem is he was always under-targeted. We're reporting live now that Amari Cooper, he's the problem in Dallas. We reporting live now that Amari Cooper, he's the issue. His money is really not the problem. It's his anticipation. It's his where he can handle it with other players.
If you don't read the newspaper, you're uninformed. If you do read it, you're misinformed.
That's the
What the truth? You can't handle the truth.
And that's the problem. Everybody, mama, uncle, about to say mammy, but I think mammy is okay. Everybody, mammy is talking about this, and uncle is talking about this. Law, do you have any evidence on that? Yeah, give me a couple seconds right here.
Review the conversation and Adam Schefter reporting that Amari Cooper there in Dallas may be released before the league year starts. Your thoughts on that and what that accomplishes for the Dallas Cowboys?
Well, I mean, look, when they signed Cooper and Zeke, and knowing that Dak was going to get his money, and then he did. I mean, how many teams can have a quarterback, running back, wide receiver combination count for what, like $70 million on your cap? I mean, no matter how large the cap number keeps going up by whatever margin, I mean, at some point that's just not sustainable. And the fact that Zeke's still around is kind of amazing, because you'd think the running back would be the one with the quickest expiration date. But it was obvious that Amari Cooper was no longer, you know, the number one target in the offense last year, that it was CeeDee Lamb 100%. You know, the fact that Amari Cooper would essentially have to speak up, which he never does.
Right.
To say, hey, I'm still here, definitely was odd, to say the least. And again, I just saw all those kids last night at the wide receiver position. I mean, right. Why would you,
you know, why would you pay?
Terrific, and he's still very young. You're talking about a $20 million hit of some sort.
Your boy said a $20 million hit. And we're going to play the rest of that. But this is your projections as it relates to the information that's out here on the franchise tag options. Right now, the franchise tag for running backs is 9.5. We don't have a problem with that. We got Ezekiel Elliott signed for a long term, right? His money is guaranteed. Quarterbacks, 29.5. We went over that before. Wide receivers, 18.5. Tight ends, 11 million. Defensive tackle, 17 million. Edge rushers, 17.5. Linebackers, 18.5. Cornerbacks, 17.5. Safety, 13 million. And then punt kickers or what have you, $5 million. So you mean to tell me, this is projected franchise tags, by the way. We talked about the DeMarcus Lawrence being a casualty, a cut casualty, right? We talked about Amari Cooper, the way they looked at his contract. This is going to be a cut casualty. We knew when we created the contract. The problem is, if we knew that, why not prep yourself to begin to trade that last season? The thing is, the Cowboys, they wait to the house, they see the fire starting. And they said, nah, it'll be okay. It's going to put itself out, right? Then it grows and it spreads. Now we okay, just a little warm in here. That fire, don't worry about it. But what happened ultimately, that fire spread so much that now you complaining about, hey, man, how dare that fire do that? Bull sugar, you should have been put the fire out before it spread it. It's not the fire fault. It's the person that had the access to put the fire out. The thing is, when we talk about this, there's no accountability for the general manager to get fired, to get executed, to get sullied or denigrated. The general manager, the person that's supposed to be in control of the coaches, the person that's supposed to be in control of the personnel. Oh, he's the owner. And his son is in second in command. But I thought, Law, that Will McClay is the general manager. Bull sugar. Who he hired? Who did he get the chance to fire? Who did he step in and said, no, we can't do this deal for a long term. No, we can't wait to pay Dak Prescott too late. We got to pay him before Carson Wentz get his money, before Jared Goff got his money. We got to get in front of that. If not, then he going to demand what they got plus more based upon his stats. Nothing to do. Nothing to do with wins or losses, but his stats speaks that he's better. Nah, we don't believe in him. So these are the problems that the Cowboys are seeing now, when the fire could have been put out earlier. That's the situation. You fool around and you've paid Ezekiel, Elijah, Elliott the extension before you gave your quarterback one. Oh, the reality of it is this right here, Cowboy Nation. Do you have any truth to this? If it was any other general manager, where he would be? Yes. Collecting cans somewhere. The reality is this right here, Cowboy Nation. You empowered a coach. I ain't talking about the head coach at this time. I'm talking about the offensive coordinator coach, who was just throwing balls around on this team as the backup quarterback, to be your coach, assistant to help Dak Prescott to be the quarterback coach for 1 year, to ultimately give him a promotion to be the offensive coordinator, who got zero experience in designing and calling up run plays.
What, the truth? You can't handle the truth.
And the problem is with that, Cowboy Nation, is that you paid $90 million to your running back. That's equivalent to me handing over the keys to my Beamer, to my daughter, who's 6 years old, who's finna turn six, by the way, with no consequences and repercussions of that matter. We took.
What, the truth? You can't handle the truth.
You literally took a baby to call this offense. And now that the offense, when you get to the playoff, about to say Super Bowl for some strange reason, but the playoffs, you want to pinpoint and say that it's one player that's the issue?
Shame. Shame. Shame.
And we ain't gonna even talk about the offensive line. But let's listen to more what these guys have to say.
We're close to it, I'd imagine. I think it was, what, $100 million contract he signed? Again, I don't know what phony money was in it or what he would count for this year. Or how.
I think it's $16 million. I think it's $16 million they save.
It's a huge chunk of change.
Yeah.
It's a huge chunk of change. You know, that Gallup is hurt, and But that doesn't surprise me. It just doesn't. And then the fact that he was one of their few unvaccinated players still on the team last year, I think really rankled the Joneses. And it's interesting, again, the COVID protocols yesterday were shelved. But still, what will linger is somebody at a time when all they had to do was take a shot, and that would give them a better chance to win, and they did not, is something that I think will linger in the mind's eye of front offices and ownership. And I think you put it all together, and that's one of the reasons why Cooper will be on another team. And, you know, obviously there will be some teams that will jump all over him, certainly when you got to start from scratch on his contract.
Well, here's the thing. Ain't no way if I'm the outside looking in and I'm sitting here like, you know how the bailout package when people looking for bailouts and they looking for it, you know, from the assistance from the government. And they said, hey, you know, when I'm getting my stimulus bailout package, basically, you know, the golden parachute. And, you know, one thing I'm going to tell y'all about here, I don't give a dog how you guys receive it, but I ain't finna sit here and lie to kick it. I'm not finna piss down your back and say, hey, man, that's okay. That yellow water, that's rain. That's not me, dog. That's not me. But the thing is, if you really think that a team is looking at this situation and saying, all right, cool, I'm gonna bail out the Cowboys by taking up that offer of, excuse me, who would do that? You know, teams really don't like to trade with the Cowboys because they gloat, they brag, they walk around with their chests out. They throw jabs. Because the whole thing is, everybody was high-fiving, laughing, and kiki-kiing when they went and got Amari Cooper from the Raiders. And at the end of the day, if that's the case in the scenario, if they knew about the lack of efforts that they trying to put on this man now, and they trying to tarnish his reputation, whether it's truth, fact, or just rumor mill out of the wazoo, right? Allegedly, Cowboys sources. If that's the case, then you would have to eat your words by giving up that draft pick, because the Raiders done fleeced you. They said, yeah. They the ones that's laughing right now at the Jones family.
No.
They're the ones laughing. Because this is the truth. Let me pull it up again for those who don't understand. They said the Cowboys thought they got a deal.
No.
The Cowboys thought that they ran off with Amari Cooper. And we fleeced they dumb. Ooh, I almost cussed. We fleeced them. How long? We got a first round draft pick out of them, and the Cowboys paid them.
No.
And their general manager with the slick back, Stephen Jones and Jerry Jones, they was laughing at us.
No.
Talking about, we going to be enjoying the highlight tape and the highlight reel of Amari Cooper. You know? and at the same breath, the Raiders since that time frame and the Dallas Cowboys since that time frame haven't done nothing equal. Haven't done nothing. But this information is not leaked out. The Cowboys organization, according to sources, don't leak out information.
With Amari Cooper, we're at the same party, around the same people, and that's where I got it from.
Amari saved Dak's career in 2018. He saved Dak's career. Dak was on a pace where he was throwing less than 200 yards in a dozen straight games. He saved Dak's career. There's a chemistry there. And the Cowboys have this stupid Chris Richard, Dan Quinn fetish where they think that just because you're an emotional person, that means you care more.
Let me pump the brakes a little bit here. Excuse me. Old folks say this too. Why don't you write this down? What's good for the goose is good for the gander. If Amari Cooper was considered to be washed and had horrible work efforts, right? Had the dropsies. Could it be the inverse too? Could, dare I say, that the Dallas Cowboys, Dak Prescott, saved Amari Cooper's career?
What the truth? You can't handle the truth.
It's as if they never read a book on psychology or something. And they just fetishize about this. Oh, we got to have a guy who's fiery. Why?
People, when this happens, if this happens, my friends are going to be blowing me up, laughing at the Cowboys and saying, what the hell are y'all thinking? What do you think Dak Prescott is going to be now, and why did you do it?
Yep.
And it's going to be a very difficult,
convoluted
explanation.
Yeah. And I do love that if they do believe that he stinks, that they're not.
Stinks?
Let's just say that they don't want him anymore.
My guy, Boss Cowboy, he's put out there, toxic people / organizations never admit that they are the ones that's toxic. Terrell Owens was too assertive, wanted the ball, so they let him go. Dez was too assertive, wanted the ball, so they let him go. Amari is not assertive enough, wanting the ball, so ... Shaking my head.
What the truth? You can't handle the truth.
I can't make this stuff up. And the brilliancy of being independent, can't nobody put a muffler on my mouth. Because I'm going to give it to y'all, whether or not you like it or not, raw. I'm just giving it to you raw. Ain't no protection over here, baby. It's going to get raw. You're going to feel every inch of this thing because this is the reality of it. Don't it feel good when you're getting it the real way?
I love that they're not worrying about the draft pick they gave up for him. It's a sunk cost. Move on. Don't worry about it. Just like the Colts with Carson Wentz. But I just disagree with the notion. I think Amari's fantastic. And I can't imagine they're remotely going to be improved. Oh. By getting rid of him and even spending $18 million on somebody else.
Check out that article right there, Cowboy Nation. That will be the full link of that video there from 105.3 The Fan, the Odyssey app. Just go check that out. Shout out to your Boss Cowboy. Appreciate those who out here that's watching. Be sure to hit that like, share this content, sharing is caring. So the news came out that this draft class is heavy on wide receivers, heavy on edge rushers, right? So when you're heavy at those two points, you can sit back and just relax a little bit and say, all right, a known commodity is better, but the unknown is really unknown. We just don't know. So we're going to lean on our evaluation. Shout out to you, Jackson. Shout out to you, Drew Simpson. Shout out to you, AJ. Thank you guys on the Facebook group. Appreciate you. You can just sit back and say, all right, I'd rather handle and deal with my own versus developing someone else. So that would be the conversational and the thought track of leaning more on, dare I say, Michael Gallup versus Amari Cooper. And of course, the money. We all love Michael Gallup. We know that the kind and caliber of person he is, right? He never complained as well. He's a happy-go-lucky guy. He's serious when he get on the field. high point the ball, aggressive. And we missed him all this past season, right? But we saw the difference when he was in the game. That third down machine, that's what I call him. Gallup on third down, baby. Oh, my goodness, I love it. He was the guy, right? But we taking a flyer or a risk when we talk about this, Cowboy Nation, because this is the situation. We don't know. Ooh, we don't know. Now, we can go back and say, well, according to history, wide receivers now that come off of that injury is not as bad as it used to be. Wide receivers coming away from that. I mean, when you think about it, it'll be a situation where we can stand up and say, these are the things that I build. These are the things that I'm on. Right? And say, we were right about that draft pick. It's all about that now, baby. It's all about who's right. Right? Let me hit this thing one more time on play it again. It's all about who can insert themselves to be, I'm right. I'm the person that's right. It's not about saying that, hey, I'm wrong. And it's time for me to move on. Because your problems, your excuses, and the situation that you're in, no. It's not because of me, it's because of him. I had somebody to say, well, they overpaid for D-Law. They overpaid for Dak Prescott. They overpaid for Ezekiel Elliott. They overpaid for Amari Cooper. Appreciate you, Boss Cowboy. They overpaid for all of those boys. Who's pulling the trigger?
What, the truth? You can't handle the truth.
DeMarcus Lawrence, let's start off with him first. They said that he's not worth Khalil Mack money. But they end up paying him Khalil Mack money. But they went with the first year of doubting the man, and they put him on the franchise tag. I recall I vividly did episodes of this. While everybody else was trying to fabricate a story, I was trying to give you guys the real, the raw, the uncut, the unfiltered version. If I was to drink, I would be that bourbon. I think I'm more of a cognac, smooth a little bit. And I said, man, they better go ahead and pay that man. We need to see a little bit more out of him. Put the $14 million franchise tag on him. Prove it. The next year, he did some similar things that he did that first year. That bag went up. $20 million. That's a $6 to $7 million increase. When all you had to do was go ahead and pay the man the first time or let him test the market. Get something back in return. But they pander. Law, was that the first person they did that with? No. They did it with Dez Bryant too. Dez had to fight for his money. Then they allowed stuff to come out about the stuff that happened at Walmart parking lot. Y'all remember that? That got in the way of his money. Dez didn't practice or he didn't do any of those things during that OTAs. That was coming off of a year. The catch, no catch. Let me know if I'm lying. They tried to get that bag lower. He came back out of shape a little bit. He probably would never admit it. He's getting IVs in the second half of the Giants game. Then he broke his toe or something like that, metal torso or something like that. But a third of you guys that's listening right now, that's the day that you guys turned on him.
What, the truth? You can't handle the truth.
But I don't know nothing. I'm just an econ major working for the government, Department of Defense, you know. That's who I am. I ain't a journalist, you know. Yeah, that's all me, you know, on the financial wing, by the way. I'm not a journalist. I'm not a beat writer. I'm me. Shout out to Jackson State.
Okay, so what do we do? Do we cut him pre-June 1? Do we cut him post-June 1? Do we see if we should just go ahead and restructure and, you know...
My guy, shout out to you, BD Gray, metatarsal. Whatever, it was the foot. Y'all can tell I'm not an English major. I was cold-blooded in math.
Balloon up his cap hit even larger than the $29 million it is in 2023. And so I think those are the things they're kicking around right now. I think that everybody involved at this point expects kind of a clean release pre-June 1. But again, that one's been muddier than the Cooper situation. If the Cowboys can find a trade partner for Cooper, they'll do it.
This just sounds personal. That one, I think, this just sounds personal on Amari. Doesn't it?
With Amari?
Yeah, there's no... They can manage the cap by keeping him. They still can. Like, it just sounds personal.
No doubt. Let's keep going. Let's listen a little bit further. Listen.
I mean, they can flip their triggers if they want. I don't think they want to do that. I think that they've been frustrated with some of the deals that they've gotten themselves into. Look, like, you look at a team like Green Bay, who is $29 million over the cap or whatever it is that they are. They have a number of options for releases to easily get themselves over the cap.
Before he go a little bit further, there was news reported that Jair Alexander, one of the better DBs I've seen in a long time to play for the Green Bay, they said, you know what, he ain't gonna start no smear campaign on him, even though he's been battling with injuries and things like that and the issues with his playing time, but they know that he's a good player. They said, man, we gonna allow this brother to seek trade. And the other report is, man, we really trying to work on an extension. But you don't hear Green Bay news saying that, hey, he ain't worth the money. Shoo, we can't pay him Ramsey money. No, man, shoo, no. But if he played for the Cowboys, woo, man, he ain't Dion. You know, that way too much money to pay Alexander. Boy, I can just only, let me stop.
The way their deals are structured, the Cowboys do all these, you know, switch flipping and everything else, Derek, to where they don't have a lot of great options of guys to move on from and clear up space and things like that. And so I think they're just a little, you know, it's caught up to them a little bit, especially with the cap not growing at the same rate that they expected. And so I think at this point they don't want to flip any more of those switches. They just want to get themselves straight. They, I think, are really frustrated by the Zeke deal and
it's the bind
that's put them in. Yeah, I know. But I mean, you can, you know, I'm sure Plexico Burress was annoyed when he shot himself in the leg, like, even though it was his fault. I'm sure he was like, now that hurt, right? But that's my fault. So same sort of thing. I think that, like, the Cowboys, it's their fault. It's their own doing, but they're annoyed by it now that it's a reality.
Yeah, we all are, as a matter of fact. Bobby Belt with us here via the Diamond Factory hotline on your DFW Sports Station, 105.3 The Fan. So with Amari leaving, does that ensures the Gallup return? And what do you feel like the numbers look like on the Gallup deal?
So the Gallup should be coming back. They're close, I think.
Number?
The exact figures, it's not totally clear yet. Look, that's one of the interesting things I heard from some people this week is, you know, trying to figure out their priorities in terms of who do they want to bring back, Malik Hooker, Jayron Kearse, Randy Gregory, like people like this. The amount of times I heard that it was like, yeah, we want to bring him back, but like just hold on for a little bit so we can figure out what our money looks like. Like, they didn't have figures to exchange with some of these people. And so, like, I think that given where they're at financially, it's tough to kind of nail down exactly where they're at in some of these discussions. But
all right, so that's Bobby Belt from 105.3 The Fan. Well, on 105.3 The Fan, shout out to Shane and RJ show in the morning. I just submitted the source for that news there in the information box, so be sure to click on that to listen to the full program there. Yes, we talked about Dak Prescott flipped the switch. So, well, nah, he didn't flip the switch, but the Jones family flipped the switch, and they're trying to free up some money. They got to get under that cap threshold, I believe, in between March the 16th and March the 20th. And I think March the 20th is the deadline for Amari Cooper. Now, there's two options with this situation with Amari Cooper. The Cowboys must realize that, hey, if Amari Cooper refuses to restructure the contract, then the best thing for them to do is to create a happy, friendly type of PR deal for him and say, man, he's amazing wide receiver. This is what is supposed to happen. He's amazing wide receiver. His time here in Dallas, man, he was supportive. Everybody kind of grew from him. CeeDee Lamb, he says that he's amazing. Even Simi Fehoko, he speaks glowingly of Amari Cooper, and we can't wait. We can't wait to see if we can keep him. Unfortunately, the price is just too high right now, and we are openly seeking trades. That should have been the conversational line with Amari Cooper. That should have been. But they took the latter. They chose violence, basically, and said, okay, he didn't wear his mask. He didn't get the shot or what have you. And it was a whole bunch of stuff that sullied the waters as it relates to Amari Cooper and painting the bad picture. Now, granted, I kid you guys this right here. All of this, let's use the word dumbfounded. Let's be naive. Let's be naive. The Jones family don't operate like that. They don't talk to the media and say things like that. That's bull sugar. They don't leak out information about players. These are all fabrications for the nation, from the nation. I'm the problem. I literally had people say that Law Nation is the problem. I'm the reason why the Cowboys are not winning. You know, I'm the reason why they don't will and deal and trade. You know,
I think as they make these moves with Cooper, potentially Lawrence, when they go ahead and restructure Dak and look into some, you know, other areas, then they should have a better idea of where their money's going to be. But I also think, like, we're trending closer towards the possibility of, like, Dalton Schultz getting tagged, and that's going to take up $11 million. Yeah. And so I think that we're just – I think you're looking at more and more of these things that could potentially complicate their money. So it's not totally clear yet where they're at with some of these deals in terms of what they're looking at for annual value.
Are they a better team by keeping Amari, signing Gallup, cutting Tank, and letting Gregory walk – or cutting Amari and cutting Tank and signing Gregory and Gallup?
I think they're better if they keep Cooper. And look, like, I love Randy, but I think they're better by keeping Cooper and Gallup, probably. That would just be, in the immediate term, I think that's what they're better.
And you can move Mike to the edge and draft a linebacker because they're easier to replace.
All right, so let me give you guys my thoughts on this. Are they a better team? All right. We all love Michael Gallup, right? We all love Michael Gallup. And I'm not saying that Michael Gallup will not be a dominant number two, right, on this team or wherever he go. But the Cowboys, if they don't get out of there, you know what? And look back at the past, good teams don't franchise tag players. I told people that the franchise tag is equivalent to payday loans. You don't go to rich communities and find payday loan centers because that don't render the market. That's some econ talking to you guys. You can't go into good community, thriving communities, and find title loan places because people with sense, people that know how to generate wealth, know to stay far, far away from title loan, payday loan, speedy cash, all of those places. They know it. But the Cowboys continue to look at the franchise tag because they operate out of the feelings and out of the mom and pops mentality, and they operate out of that. And they look into that and they say, we going to franchise tag. Case in point, the Cleveland Browns, I think today, did they just franchise tag David Njoku? Oh, okay. But that's a story of a different day. That's the Cleveland Browns, right? We're not the Cleveland Browns. I digress. What the Cowboys need to do in this situation, figure it out on how they're going to look at this Michael Gallup coming off of his injury, see what the open market is willing to render, and see what the open market is willing to pay Dalton Schultz. Because if you fool around and say, okay, we're going to cut D-Law, we're going to cut Amari Cooper, that's majority of your production. And I get it, DeMarcus Lawrence, his overall perceived value is very low because he don't get the gaudy sacks that everybody like to see. His numbers is down in the trenches almost, playing at the edge. He's one of the top defenders against the run, but that's not sexy enough. That's not the sexy Lambo. I feel you, right? That contract is too heavy. But DeMarcus Lawrence is looking at this thing and saying, hey, I restructured my contract last year. So I get what you're trying to do. You're trying to pull a fast one on me. I restructure. You give me the money up front. Think I'm happy. And this year around, you want to cut it. Nah. Hey, you putting too much baking soda in that. No. Nah. You can't flip that key this way. Nah, this just ain't finna happen. Baby, no. I'm gonna check out the market elsewhere. Allegedly, right? He can see the writing on the wall. He know what y'all try to do. Try to pull a fast one. His services elsewhere can be very warranted. We did the same thing to the D-Ware. Hey, D-Ware, you ain't really worth the money, baby. Yeah, DeMarcus and company, nah, you ain't worth the money. Nah, we good. We ain't going to pay you. He go to Denver land. Started off a little slow. Got back. I think his second year. Lifted up the Lombardi Trophy.
Yeah, this is everything that you do is just like
I got bacon soda.
How do I get Mike in a can? Yeah, I know. Sorry, I just wanted to get in a can. Excuse me.
It's like, you know, Dak had left shoulder surgery, and you know, are just going, well, that's great because you know, they can't hit him anymore in practice. Like, that would be really bad for that shoulder. So Mike can't be at the linebacker and spine up. So we'll just put him at defensive end. And so like, there's always some connection for Chop to figure out how to get Mike in there,
man.
I think he will play more snaps at edge next year.
Oh, my goodness. Okay. Bobby Belt with us here via the Diamond Factory fan hotline. The Dalton Schultz likely to get – we're trending closer to him likely to get tagged just has me
– I think that's a hold, by the way. I think that's just something they're going to try and, like, basically have a placeholder while they try and work out something that would lower that cap figure on an extension.
So when you talk about a hold, and I appreciate you guys for following along, they did the hold three times in my experience here, and they could have did it more. They did the hold with D-Law. They signed him to the franchise tag to work out. You know, you get a chance to extend it, I believe, June, I think up until mid-June-ish to work out that long-term contract, and they did it. They worked out the long-term contract, right? But any moves at that point, that's a big hit off your cap, so you really don't dance. And the situation for this would be this right here. We sign guys, we sign our own, right? And they put the hold, of course, on Dak Prescott the second time. It was $37.8 million on the franchise tag. And they went through the negotiations. And remember, I think this was just last year, right? And they were saying, if you play again on the tag or what have you, it will be a 37.8 big hit immediately. And you can't disperse or you can't supplement that money once the tag hit is the tag, right? And then when they get up with the long-term contract, then you can break that down. But shout out to Dak Prescott because he did at least restructure, because I believe that's how the contract was already written, the voidable years in that contract. And to be fair, like I'm saying, I'm being so fair with my guy Ezekiel Elliott, because I'm telling you guys, Ezekiel Elliott is not the problem. He is part of the scapegoat plan too. He is. He is flat out part of it. And what I need to do is going to take me a minute is break down all of Ezekiel Elliott's outside runs to show you guys better than I can tell you. Even, look, I'm trying to find the Ezekiel Elliott clip now. Jeez. Here we go. Even in that 49ers game, averaging 4.5 yards per rush on the edge. But when they were pulling, you had doggone Malik Turner out there. Didn't know. Now, you're talking about Amari Cooper not blocking. I was looking at it like, what is Malik is doing? And when you insert Noah Brown in it, I mean, you insert Noah Brown into the offense, you already know. You already know that they finna run. Gene Byram says, Zeke can't catch that. I will subside with you on. But the Cowboys' number one issue, they don't know how to craft up no running plays. Offensive coordinator, yeah, I feel you. Offensive line, yeah, I feel you. Boy, that's a story of a different day. It's a big story of a different day.
You're basically saying they don't really have necessarily their numbers all together. I mean, isn't that kind of an organizational flaw right now? Wouldn't you think an NFL team should kind of know what they're doing with their cap numbers, especially one that continues to reiterate the salary cap anytime you ask them about any offseason moves?
I think they have some general ideas. I just don't think they have a lot of specifics or exact figures that have been exchanged on some of these guys yet. But I think they have general ballpark targets and things like that. And I think there's an understanding from, the Cowboys and some of these agents as to where the general vicinity is. But yeah, I think they're not sure because of the factor of potentially the tag and who they're going to restructure and who they're going to let go and what exactly will be on their books. A lot of these meetings were taking place before they got the outright rejection from DeMarcus Lawrence about taking a pay cut. So that, you know, complicated them knowing exactly how much wiggle room they had. But
it is what it is on that one. All right. Test right here. Based off of this formation, what the Cowboys about to do. You got the two high safeties, right? Too high. What the Cowboys going to do? I'm going to read the comments. Based off that formation, what the Cowboys about to do? Based off of that formation, what the Cowboys about to do? Run or pass? Appreciate you, Mark. Pollard seems to run fine and get more yards and receiving. Yeah, Mark, appreciate you for the donation. I agree. Pollard got more wiggle. I mean, he wasn't the guy running with the PCL tear. Pollard is a good running back, by the way. Motion 87 inside. Is this good? Who's supposed to pick up who? Collins going to pick up this guy? This guy going to pick up him? It should be one-on-one versus this point right here, right? Is this a successful play or a failure play? Success or failure? Pause it again. How many yards? 5 yards off of that. 5 yards off of that run. Let's look at it from this angle. Our formation. You see him at a wide look, right? Collins not even going to block him. He's going to swing out. You're going to have 87 to come in to make this block right here. Come on in and make that block. There you go. He get right inside. 17, he's whiffs on this. He said, I don't want no part of this linebacker. He going to get the outside shoulder, and he keep moving forward. Ezekiel Elliott, look, I don't care what y'all say. You continue to go back to that look. Flip it to the other side. Mano y mano, I'm going to toss this thing until they stop it. And then when Ezekiel Elliott is gasp, I put TP in the game. We don't run the ball enough, Cowboy Nation. I don't care, man. 5.5 off of the edge. I'll take that. 5 or 5.5 off the edge. I'll take that. Yeah, he did lose his feet. Come on now. But we would look. And that's with a PCL tear, baby. I can't make this up.
I think that, you know, they are getting things, trying to get their ducks in a row. And like I said, we should have a better idea, I think, this week as to exact figures and things like that. But, you know, I would hope they get the Gallup deal done this week. I think it's getting closer to the idea that they're going to tag Schultz, but I think they'd work on a deal at that point. I think it's just to buy them some time. And then, I would expect the Dak restructure coming soon to free up some money.
And that already happened. Yeah, this is an older episode, Cowboy Nation. And like I said, I don't want you guys to think that I'm yelling and I'm mad at you all. No. That's not the case. Shout out to you, QBO88, false star. Yeah. But what I'm saying is, for anybody and anyone to pinpoint one issue with the Cowboys and not look at their front office and give them a golden parachute, right, and say that, well, they faultless. They don't make no problems with these contracts. You know, if you believe that, then come on, man, you know. If you believe that the Cowboys front office is faultless at this and the way they handle this scenario,
you must be out of your goddamn mind.
And immediately you see the progression, maturation, and the progression of Dak Prescott until he got what? Amari Cooper. Yep. And once he got Amari Cooper, he took off. He had Dez Bryant for several years, and Dez wasn't the same Dez. Dez was not getting the 50-50 ball. He could no longer run. His body was battered and bruised, and it started to take its toll. He gets Amari Cooper, and immediately you see the progression that Dak Prescott underwent. To the defensive side of the football, D-Law, this is the best D-Law I've seen. Granted, Skip, he missed some time with the injury, but this is the best D-Law I saw in the last 3 years. The thing that D-Law doesn't get credit for is because he doesn't have the sack totals of a Myles Garrett or T.J. Watt or the Bosas.
Yeah.
But he's tremendous at stopping the run. Pro Football Focus say he's the best defender and edge rusher at stopping the run.
Let me double check right quick. Let me go Pro Football Focus. Shout out to Ezekiel Elliott. Trust but verify, right? And who's grading? 91 overall, 93.2. Okay. That's pretty good. Solo tackles 15, assistant 2, forced fumbles 2. Hits 4, total pressure 27. Okay.
He's the fourth rated overall behind Miles Garrett, Mason Crosby, and Von Miller. He was ahead of T.J. Watt, the Bosa's Cam Jordan, and Shaq Barrett.
Yep.
So in totality, Skip, when you combine now, totality. Will he go get you 12, 14 sacks? Probably not. I think he's probably more of a 7 to 10 sack guy, Skip, if he plays the entire season. But his run, the way he can set an edge, is second to none. Mm. So I get why the Cowboys are doing that. What's not surprising about me, let me go back to Amari, Skip. I should have stayed with Amari the first time. What's not surprising is that what Jerry has shown you over the course of his career, that he never loves free agents like he loves the guys that he drafts.
That's true.
He's shown you that because here's the thing, Skip, and I'm reading, they say they have a question with Amari's durability. Michael Gallup has missed way more time. Skip, remember the guy had the calf injury. He comes back after the calf injury, Skip, plays one game and tears his ACL. So here's a guy that's coming off an ACL injury and you're looking to do a long-term deal with him as opposed to a guy, now granted, I get a $20 million salary right. And he hasn't given you $20 million of production. Big but facts. I don't believe either guy was going to be looking to take a pay cut, Skip, because they see the landscape. Somebody out there needs a number one receiver. Somebody out there needs a defensive end. I ain't taking no pay cut to stay here when I can go out there and I can get the dollars that I'm supposed to make originally here.
Yep.
Skip, I think it's going to hurt because we have not seen Dak get to a level and stay here throughout the course of the season.
That I can agree on. Shout out to you, Matthew. Law, you should hold the Jones accountable, make a video solely on them and all the problems they cause. Yeah. Oh, my gosh, yeah. And here's the situation. The Jones family, believe it or not, since 1996 until now, the average win-loss, if you add in all of those years until now, we are right at 8-8, right at 500. I think we're north. I think we are just above 500. And that is not terrible enough. Because the problem is, when y'all was looking at the Cincinnati Bengals and you was like, yeah, that Joe Smooth, that Joe Burrows, man, he nice, man. That dude right there, dog, he nice. Yeah, that Jamar Chase, man, woo! Hey, you see T. Higgins? Boy, them boys nice. Joe Mixon, yeah. But they had to. Superhead sucked to get to that point. To draft those boys and build that team for multiple years. And the Jones family, believe it or not, under Jason Garrett, the 10 years that he's been here, you can count on your hand how many losing seasons we had. So we were stuck right at that middle place. So we are not able to draft real low to get those kind and caliber type of quarterbacks, right? Or those kinds and caliber types of wide receivers and beyond. One can argue that this particular team been drafting right at this spot where we're drafting at this coming up draft for a long time, right in the 20s, 24-ish, and we will have to move up. We have to move up to get that kind and caliber type of, dare I say it, said type of quarterback or players in general. But the Cowboys, by the stroke of magical luck, we had Tony Romo for all of those years. And then leaving from Tony Romo, we had Dak Prescott. But the time that we had the chance and opportunity, and I'm glad we didn't pick one of those quarterbacks like a Carson Wentz or a Jared Goff, we drafted Ezekiel Elliott. In my humble opinion, was a good pickup for us outside of drafting for Carson Wentz, a Goff moving up, you know. You know, if you were to move up That was your prime opportunity. Right? So we never had a chance, an opportunity. What we said, Jalen Ramsey was hit high on my board there too. Right? And I heard people say we could have, you know, pretty much drafted Jalen Ramsey with the fourth overall pick, right? Jalen Ramsey got drafted in the fifth overall, right? We could have drafted Jalen Ramsey. And this is us going back trying to put toothpaste back in the tube. And then in the second round, you go get Derrick Henry. I wonder how that dynamics would have worked out. I can hear you guys now. Oh, Derrick Henry, he ain't worth it. He can't catch out of the backfield. I'm just playing with y'all, right? Shout out to y'all. But the next time we had an opportunity to get drafted, like, real early, and I think that Dak Prescott, amazing. Fourth-round draft pick, the second pick out of the fourth round. Out of that draft class, name me a better quarterback than Dak Prescott out of that 2016 draft class. Right? But what the Cowboys should have done when they found out, like, hey, man, the next year, like, but they kept going back and forth. The argument was Dak ain't no Jared Goff, nor is he Carson Wentz. Y'all remember that? I think an Eagle fan can really go back and forth and say, yeah, man, Carson Wentz is better. MVP Wentz was at least on the pace to being the MVP. That was the argument. That was the argument for a long time. Yeah, Corey says, but damn long, if it was a fifth. But that's just how it went. We went fighting all of these years. And I think that Mark Holmes was one of the guys that was leading the parade. He was actually leading the parade and saying, hey, you got to pay Dak Prescott. Right? He was leading the band on that one. I don't think nobody was in front of him on that one. Let me know. If I'm lying, I'm flying. Cowboys fool around, let old Goff and Wentz get paid first, and we knew.
See him do this?
Appreciate you, Isaiah. He said Senior J. Crazy. Oh, my gosh, man. Appreciate you. Appreciate you. But there goes to show you that all the Cowboys had to do, and I get it, we was in semi-cap hell because of the contract that we were still paying for Tony Romo, and the semi-cap hell that we were still paying for Dez Bryant. And I think it wasn't until, believe it or not, to the year 2018-ish, that the bad contract for Miles Austin didn't come off the book, you know? So that's crazy.
He does this. He play a bad team, does that. Play a good team, does this. So we haven't seen the level, the greatness, get to a level and stay through the totality of it.
Totality.
D-Law is perfect for DQ, Dan Quinn's scheme, mm-hmm. Skip. Yeah. He's about a 6'4", 285-pound defensive end that can rush, speed, power, great against the run. So I think if they were to lose both of these guys, I think it's going to be a tremendous, it would be a tremendous loss. Also, Skip, I believe they're going to lose more. Because I believe guys, what guys are starting to see, Skip, at any given time, a pandemic can happen again. Mm-hmm. And what happened during the pandemic? The salary cap went down. Salary cap goes down, salary gets suppressed. Now the salary is starting to go up. I'm trying to get all the money I can get, Skip. I'm sorry, Jerry. I like it here in Dallas, but I can't give you any money back. Mm. I worked too hard to get it, especially D-Law missed some time last year with a bad back.
He did. Mm.
Now, I need to get all my money. So I think it'll be a seven. I'm going to go a seven. If neither guy, Skip, is even though he rated ahead of a lot of these guys, I don't believe he's better than T.J. Watt. I don't believe Cooper is one of the Amari Cooper is Cooper Kupp or Tyreek Hill or Devontae Adams. He's a solid receiver.
Here it is right here. I know I wasn't crazy. Miles Austin. We had signed a 7-year, $54 million contract. and we still owed him $17 million to the year of 2017 at the time. I can't make this stuff up.
No.
You know? and of course, he wasn't playing for us or what have you. And, of course, we had to eat of it, of that dead money, you know. So there goes to show you. You know, I think Miles Austin was one of the and then I think he signed a one-year deal in 2015 with the Eagles. Believe it or not, since you guys are in here, you know, let me see. I don't know if he's going to show. Yeah, he ain't going to show. And let me see if I can just help you guys out right quick. Yeah, he's going to show right here. You see that? The Eagles, 2015, $2.3 million, right? 14, he played with the Browns. But 2010 through 2016, he was still on the books. Hey, why law? Because you couldn't find a trading partner with him. You know, we cut him. Huh? And we had all of that money, that $54 million. But that's not the Cowboys' fault. That's Law Nation's fault, you know? It was Law. Look, I get it. You know, we were paying him in 2017 because it was Law Nation's fault. You know, good old Miles Austin. Let me see if I can pull up his picture and everything. Let me see if y'all can see his face. Yeah. Yeah, the good old Miles Austin. They left him with the Eagles logo and everything on his name. Oh, my gosh, man. Look, Jay Lombardi, I'm not going to talk about the DeMarco Murray situation because we end up letting him go, right? But we ain't getting nothing in return. But that's a story for today.
For whatever reason, he just have these.
Y'all don't like Lowe.
He'll give you 120-yard game skipping, and he'll go three or four games where he gives you 40, and I can't explain it. And that's been his history. That's why the Raiders moved on from him, Skip.
That is correct.
I'm like, damn, Amari, how you give us two games of 120, and then you give us five games of 40? It's like...
Targets, man.
I don't question the guy's desire. I don't question his passion. But I'm like, damn, I just can't get... he's one guy, Skip, I can't get a read on.
Okay, back to the question. It's scale of 1 to 10 on the trouble scale. How much trouble are the Cowboys in if they lose both Amari and D-Law?
Yes.
My head says 9. My heart says 3.
Okay.
I'm clinging to glass half empty, full, right?
You like, give it a go 5 or 6.
I'm going glass is still half full, even though my head is telling me the window has officially closed on this team.
Right.
Why did the window slam shut after last year? Because my quarterback, number 4, my quarterback took $75 million last year. My quarterback just pinned old Jerry right up against the wall, and then he took
it. He shook him down. He shook him down, Skip.
FBI, open up!
You know, all right, that's enough of that. I can't listen to more of the Skip Bayless stuff. But, boy, QB said, damn, Law, you were paying everybody. No. My stance is if we hold on to players for so long. And, you know, and I'm going to be real with y'all. The reason why Miles Austin fell off because he was dating one of those Kardashians, and that's the story of a different day. You see what happened when they leave you. You know, you go crazy. But that's the story of a different day. The thing is, we don't know how to will and deal. We don't. We flat out do not know how to will and deal. Do any... Yeah, Kardashian fought on that one, you know. They done dated everybody that's popular, you know. I never forget. I was in one of the LAX airport. They said, yeah, you used to date one of the Kardashians. I said, no, I didn't. Yes, you did. You James Harden. I said, no, I'm Law Nation, baby. If I stand up, you see that I'm not 6'5", baby. But it is what it is. But I think one of the Kardashians dated Harden, you know, but they thought that that was me, but I wasn't him, you know. But that's a story of a different day. Count Bayless, shout out to you. So, who pent who against the wall? Did Dak Prescott really put the flames, put all of the problems, hard problems for Dak? Did it really come to Dak Prescott against Jerry Jones? Let's just pull up this thing again. Dak Prescott, and I'm not a Dak Prescott apologist, by the way. I just call a spade, but I get it. You know, y'all wanna say that I am, and I get it, right? Let's go all the way back to this thing right here. Yeah, 2021 career earnings. Let's go right career earnings. Y'all. Can y'all see that on your screen? Oh, yeah, you guys can see that on your screen. 16, he made $1 million. 17, he made $941,000. 2018, he made $630,000. I was saying to you guys, he making Rico Gathers money. Undrafted guy money. You know what I'm saying? That's in 2018. We made it to the playoff in 2018. In 2019, he made $2.1 million. That's a big payday for him. And then in 2020, that's when the tag money and all of that stuff kicked in. So $31 million. And then in 2021, that's when he signed his big old contract of $75 million. So in between this time to that time, from 16 to 19, what is he supposed to do? You know, what is he supposed to do? When he can literally look into this thing and say, all right, cool. Let me do this. Let me do this right quick. Make everybody sit at this thing right here and look. I think that's how you spell Jared Goff. Should pop up. Career earnings. This dude, first round draft pick in 2016, made $18 million. And then before 2019, he made $26 million. We're not even counting in between. I don't know about you guys, but if I'm performing a task and a duty, whereas people are coming in to sack me, to hit me, to try to knock my head off, I want to get paid what he getting paid. We playing the same sport, the same field. And if my stat line is equivalent to your stat line, I think that I deserve the same amount of money, remunerations. But let's go over here. Let's type in Carson Wentz. Because I get it, these guys first round draft pick, but you don't think that these boys talk to each other and say, hey, man, hold on, how much bread you got? Yeah, you might have beat me in the stat sheet. But, man, I wiped my butt with what you made last year, man. Y'all don't think these guys don't talk to each other like that? Or the agent, dare I say? $18 million, 2016. Let me go right here. Where Dak? Where you at? Dak, where you at? Where you at? This brother didn't make the amount of money that they made until the year 2020. To the year 2020. Sleep Number ain't paying him $18 million. Pepsi ain't paying the brother $18 million. Because in their particular state and city, they got a Sleep Number deal too. They got endorsements too.
Even though my head is telling me the window has officially closed on this team.
Right.
Why did the window slam shut after last year?
Listen to this dude again.
Because My quarterback, number right four, my quarterback took $75 million last year. My quarterback just pinned old Jerry right up against the wall, and then he took
he shook him down. He shook him down, Skip.
He took him to the cleaners, and then he took him to the bank.
And let me do one more. Let me do one more. And let me do one more look up. Let me go look up. Since we're talking about money, right? Since we want to talk about that. This is Ezekiel Elliott. Running backs don't make what quarterback makes. I get it. But his rookie year, $16 million. And that's where he drafted at. That's where he drafted at. How much money? So you mean to tell me Ezekiel got $16 million? Did he say, hey, Dak, you know, I'm the one draft pick in here. And although, you know, how the thing work out, you got the MVP or the rookie MVP, whatever it was, the rookie of the year, and we're going to split that trophy. But you mind splitting some of this? I'm going to split some of this money with you? No. From the next year, $1 million, of course, this is how rookie contracts are. 18, he got the $2.7 million. And then in 2020, he got his big payday. But overall, he got the $90 million contract collectively. So with that being said, Ezekiel Elliott is the wise one. So that's how the money thing roll, baby. Come on now. We need the middle of the line help on both sides. Greg Berry, I feel you. First round pick compared to a fourth round pick, Law. I get it. But it's the same field, right? So what I'm trying to say is what I'm trying to say. Hear me out. I'm glad you mentioned that Michael Helton. Woo! So what do that mean? All you had to do was win. Hear me out, Cowboy Nation. Going into his third year before he even pick up a football. Let's give him the offer. Because they had the availability at that time. Give him the money. You could have gave Dak Prescott $22 to $25 million. APY, and we won't be having this conversation. Now, do that mean that you pay D-Law? Well, that's the choice that you have to live with. What's more important for the team right now, the quarterback, franchise quarterback, or D-Law? That would be the choice that you have to deal with. Because I'm thinking at this point, you still let some guys go, and it wasn't D-Law or bust, and you still had money left. You had enough money in 2019 to franchise tag the man for $30 million. That's a straight-up cap hit to play on it. But that's the story of a different day. Some people is going to go over their head, and they're going to be like, nah, man. But if you really feeling froggy about your player, did the Raiders pay Amari Cooper? Did the Raiders pay Amari Cooper? No. They got something in return, a first-round draft pick, and escaping the responsibility of paying their guy. Did the Patriots pay Chandler Jones? No. That dude had more sacks than any defensive edge guy collectively. They escaped it. He even got caught with fake marijuana. You know, they said, man, what's going on with him? He got caught with that spice. What my
smoke weed every day.
He got caught with the spice. And they said, you know what? His numbers are looking pretty good. but we ain't going to sully him. We're not going to talk bad about him. We're not going to ridicule the guy. We're not going to smear campaign the guy. We're going to look for offers. We're going to shop him around. We're going to clean up everybody everywhere. Clean up everybody. Do your share. That's what my daughter's saying. Didn't he get traded? Was there any smeared campaign about him? If Chandler Jones played for the Cowboys, I can only imagine what they would have done and said and leaked out about Chandler Jones. I can't make this stuff up. They got something in return. And he wasn't the first guy. And I'm not saying that the Patriots philosophy is bulletproof. But come on now. It's not rocket science. If you're going to release a guy, get something in return from the guy. Get something.
And he fleeced him for $75 yeah. million. Last year, Tom Brady made $26 million. $75 million, mm-hmm. I'm including.
Well, now, I knew I had to play this one. Won't you lean forward just a little bit? Tom Brady. Tom Brady is a non-comparison to anybody in the National Football League. You can't compare Tom Brady to what he takes as money. On his way out, he's trying to win a championship. By hook or by crook, he made his coins. Man been playing for almost 50 years almost, and he's only 40. Something. That's the one guy I couldn't stand for multiple years, and I had to sit back and swallow it and say, you know what? He just wins. Regardless, the universe opens up and shine upon him. But he couldn't beat those Rams, though. They didn't pay enough money. They said, look, dog, we love you, Tom, but, man, we got to have this Super Bowl in L.A., dog. We got to have this Super Bowl in L.A., man. You said you about to retire. You know, we can only hire so many bodies, man. Come on, man. You know, we need to erect another person, baby.
Including the bonus on
right.
top.
Yeah.
It's such a cap hit that they are now $25 million over the cap.
Right.
And because my quarterback bled Jerry for every last penny that he could get from him, they are in this predicament, mm-hmm. right?
That dude, Skip Bayless. Is he? Now, this is the person I can't stand. For y'all out here just trying to fabricate me beefing with Mike Fisher. No. I don't beef with Mike Fisher. Mike Fisher, cool dude. We have a common goal. We want the Cowboys to win the Super Bowl, right? We don't think that. We know for sure that Skip Bayless is not out here wanting the Cowboys to win the Super Bowl. he would have preferred Tom Brady to win the Super Bowl. But for Dak Prescott to squeeze the Cowboys for every penny, it's quite strange that he did today restructured his contract, which was already written, right? They're going to hold Kellen Moore accountable. It's his job to get his playmakers the ball consistently. You know what, Hilton, appreciate you for that comment there, but it's Kellen Moore's job right here to learn. He's on the job training. He's learning on the job. There was an article that was out, and I don't know if it was from thecowboys.com, but you guys can type it in and let me know who the article really came from. But it was Kellen Moore saying that, I'm not finna go over the things that went right last season. I'm finna go over the things that went wrong. And all of us can literally do this right here. Open up, Kellen Moore. Open your mind. You know what went wrong? You started a running back who had a PCL tear, and you knew about it. Ain't no way you didn't. If you didn't knew about it, then this would be more calm down. You know, I would donate $100 to charity to the first beat reporter who have access to whatever organization that they believe in. I would donate $100 in the mighty name of the business of Law Nation Sports to whoever asked Kellen Moore in the presser, going back to last year, when did you knew that Ezekiel Elliott had the PCL tear? And hold him accountable to that. And I would also raise it to another $100 if somebody asks him why you didn't think it would be a brilliant idea to rest him until we get to the playoff to utilize him, right? Instead of running a running back who's injured. It's similar to what I made the other analogy on, of you send the check engine light on and you think it's just a pretty light to light up your dashboard. But the check engine light is an indicator that you, my friend, need to get this particular vehicle inspected. You, my friend, don't need to continue to travel, because eventually what's going wrong with the engine or what's problematic with the engine will show up. And one thing that I can tell you guys about, you know, the things what old folks say, you know, you might want to write this down. If you take good care of your car, the car will take good care of you. So the issue in the situation will not show up at the wrong time, right? But when you don't take care of what you need to take care of, it will be raining, it will be dark, it will be in a situation that you need the emergency. You guys don't have to like me, right? Right? You guys can say that Law is delivering fake news over here, but you might want to put this down in your mental mindset, and it could help you. If your check engine light is on, don't wait too late. And then don't try to go get the self-diagnostic tool that you can get from AutoZone or O'Reilly and say, I'm just going to put the thing in and clear it because it's just a sensor that's gone bad, right? You get it fixed because it could be something else that's wrong with it. And you can be traveling with you and your loved ones on the family members, and you get into a situation that you really need to use your vehicle, and then all of a sudden your car get to shaking. And I'm speaking to you guys off of experience, right? And it's raining and it's pouring down. And now you're on the side of the road because you refuse to take care of the little things. So that's, my friend, is the issue. Not talking about penalties, not talking about overcoming adversities and all of this stuff. We are the Dallas Cowboys, and everybody see the issues. As the fan base, you know, talking about this stuff from left to right about this organization. But y'all prefer to say, you know what? I be God dogging. It's not Kellen Moore's situation. He's on the job training. He's a brilliant young guy. But all we have can tell you guys right now, your Twin Empire, you knew about that Honda Civic, baby. You know, that boy got the shaking. And my brother would tell you, boy, I put some money into that doggone car, you know. But it didn't matter. It don't matter how much money you put into it. Man, boy, I tell y'all, boy, I outspoke my wisdom teeth over here, baby. But I'm going to tell you guys right now. Kellen Moore is on the job training. He's learning. So to leave you guys with some positivity, because I know there's a lot of negative news around the Cowboys, the positive aspect of this is that he is wiser, smarter, and more knowledgeable than what he was last year and the year before that. He got more experience, mechanic law, than what he had last season. Mike McCarthy, regardless of what the media like to leak out, he got his back against the wall. And regardless of what the four ladder and the three ladder networks say, or what whoever is getting paid to say whatever, we know the writing is on the wall, right? Everyone have a reason, but results are what matter. So regardless, like what my dog Big Game James said, he really don't give a dog what happened to these players as long as you replace them with players that can make something happen. So my thing is, and my stance is, I'm the same way. We just want to win games. But we are tired. We are so sick and tired of the finger being pointed at the players. It was Cheeto's fault, right? We looked up, we saw him in the Super Bowl. It was Anthony Hitchens' fault. We looked up, we saw him in the Super Bowl. It was DeMarcus Ware. We looked up and we saw him in the Super Bowl. It was Martellus Bennett's fault. Marty B, it was his fault. We looked up, we saw him in the Super Bowl. Oh, it's got to be sure Chris Canty's fault. We look up and we saw him in the Super Bowl. Right? Oh, we need to do a different philosophy. We no longer need Jason Hatchard, you know what I'm saying? Who had the last defensive interior guy with multiple, I think, double-digit sacks. He was the last guy. I think we haven't had an interior defensive player to have double-digit sacks since then. It was his fault. We let him go to the Washington football team. He was way too much money. Come on, baby. But in actuality, it's Law of Nature's fault, the reason why the Cowboys haven't won in all of these years, especially to certain people on social media. It's Law of Nature's fault. Multiple people say, oh, it's Law of Nature's fault. He's the reason why. And every time I hear it,
you must be out of your goddamn mind.
You know, this is crazy, you know. But it is what it is.
What, the truth? You can't handle the truth.
Yes, indeed. We can only judge increased wisdom for next season. We cannot say he is wiser just yet. Oh, no. Ibum, INC. Thou shalt decree a thing and it shall be established, right? We speaking it into existence. We have to say he won't make the same mistakes that he made the previous year, right? They will put pieces and things around him to make him better. Because this draft, I'm telling you guys, I've seen defense like what the Cowboys did this past offseason with Dan Quinn, who Michael Parsons said got the juice. And I'm trying to leave you guys with some positive thoughts. Defense win championships. And I saw Jordan Davis out there. There is a situation that out of all of these guys, we're looking at this list right here, not saying that Kyle Hamilton or Aiden Hutchinson would be there or Evan Neal. But I guarantee you that out of these guys, somebody's going to fall to the 24th pick. And Nakobe Dean, Daxton Hill, look at all these guys, Zion Johnson, who had the most bench presses out of this combine, and who's really counting, right? You know, who threw around 225. Even if it is a Treylon Burks, who knows? He can catch fire. I can't wait to get back to talking about optimism, right? Of saying that, yeah, let them get rid of Amari Cooper. Let them get rid of D-Law. We got $24 million now. My thing is, I'm not mad at the fact that the Cowboys got to let those boys go. And I want you guys to understand this. My only thing, and I talk with passion, so I'm not mad. So that's just how I sound when I'm passionate. So what it is, so I'm not the angry black guy, by the way. I'm just talking with passion, you know, with a little girth in my voice, you know, wide versions of me. But what it is that what I want to see is the Cowboys, if they say that they're going to do all of this with that money, with the $24 million that they can recoup and save, and they already restructured, allegedly, supposedly, Dak Prescott contract, saving $15 million. So with all of this money that they got available now, You go out there, and if you want to sign and free up your guy Michael Gallup, what I'm saying is you better make a dog good decision in this draft. And we're looking at these good list of names that they better make sure they hit on these boys. And somebody's going to fall to the 24th pick. You just got to make sure you pick on the right one, right? So we can look at that, and we are not finna draft another Taco, right? We are not finna speak that into existence. We're not finna draft another LVE. If so, we're gonna get rookie version of LVE on a consistent basis, right? We can look into those things. But it's the way. I'm gonna say this again until I'm Cowboys blue in the face. It's not the fact that we're getting rid of Amari Cooper or DeMarcus Lawrence. Is in the nature of how we getting rid of those guys. We get nothing in return. Even the Raiders got a first-round draft pick out of Amari Cooper. Dogger, we can't flip it and get a third at least. We can't say, hey, dog, somebody take this salary. Mammy, you got $60 million worth of cap space. Come on, give us one of those third-round draft picks. I would like to have a second. Let me work out a deal. Amari, you from Florida? You know, Jerry, I do got a yacht. I'll send the owner a yacht, some Johnny Walker Blue, and I got a third-round draft pick, and you take on the salary. But dependent and predicated upon how he play, it could be a conditional second. Will that be a deal for you? Think about it. You got the young quarterback. You got Jalen Waddle on the opposite side. That could work out wonders for you and your organization. 19 would look good over there for your young quarterback. That's willing and dealing. But we don't do that. We don't do that. We don't. Watch out. The Falcons just lost Ridley and have a 2 second round draft picks. Yeah, I think that the Falcons really got in trouble, right? He had to pay a fine or something like that, or possibly got to pay a fine. Cal Van Noy. Yeah, they just lead. Yeah. Moore is good, but he lacks situational awareness. This is from Omega. Yeah. And that's going to be all in the developments, too. Let's see. Appreciate you, Marlon. Appreciate you so much for jumping in. All right, I done yelled at y'all long enough. I really appreciate y'all for jumping in. I thought that I was going to do only an hour, but I felt like how long I've been live, Cowboy Nation? Really is suspended for the full year? They suspended him for the full year? Dang, that's... But he had some mental stuff that was going on, you know. He's suspended for gambling. So the owners can do it, but the players can't. Oh, my gosh. Oh, he got suspended for the 2022 season. What he was gambling on, you know. Man, he down there in Georgia. The moment he said that he didn't like football, who knows, man, who put something to that man head. Mm-hmm. Man, this stuff bigger than what you think, baby. That's all that I'm going to say on that, you know.
What the truth? You can't handle the truth.
No doubt, no doubt. So... It's all in the flavor right there. Parlay and gambling, okay. Yep. Cowboy Nation, that's all we want. We want to win. And like I said, there's people out there. At the end of the day, we just want to win. Right? That's what we want to do. I think... What was it? It was the year of 2014. We had our high hopes for that season and the start of the OTAs. Sean Lee, we was like, Sean Lee, can't wait till him get back, man. Sean Lee gonna be the man, he gonna be the truth. And I think that was Zach Martin. Was that Zach Martin first year? Snap up everything. Dang, Sean Lee, why you had to run up on Zach Martin? Out for the year. Everybody was selling everything off. We don't have our lead on defense anymore. That ended up being a quasi or semi-successful year, depending on how you look at it, right? It's quite strange. In 2016, same situation. We go on to the Super Bowl, baby. We got a healthy Romo back. We got an Ezekiel Elliott. Right? Defense is going to be a whole lot better. I remember and I recall at that preseason game in Seattle, we were like, man, come on, Romo, you don't have to prove nothing, right? Romo was like, sure, I got to prove something to somebody, mama, uncle, or cousin, that I can still sling that thing. Then he get injured out for the season. Everybody said, we do. We got butt fumble. We got Kelly Moore. And we got a fourth round draft pick out of Dak Prescott. We doomed. We went all the way to the playoffs. Didn't win a playoff game, by the way. So I chuckled real hard when I heard that Mike McCarthy talking about handling adversity. Shoot. That's all we know. Is that. We need the coaches to coach better, though. We need to get out of our own way. We do. Yep, every year we started off just like that. 2021, same situation, right? Man, that guy, he coming back from a shoulder situation, meat falling off the bone. He can't throw. He can't hit water if he fell off a boat, and he had one of his better years. It's not our fault, right? But the Cowboys need to figure this thing out, Cowboy Nation. We do. We flat out do need to figure this thing out. And I'm quite sure that this draft is going to roll around and come around. And we're going to have our hopes back up high. But it's Law Nation fault, right, baby? Because I'm too optimistic. But it is what it is. Cowboy Nation. Yeah, I read your comment. Yeah, they are treating guys like that sometimes. Claude, have mercy. Appreciate you, Greg Berry. Every year we got these issues. Every year we have these problems, right? We good. Greg Berry said 12-5 and getting better. That is growth from the previous year of that previous year. See how hard we grade this day? Let's stop ridiculing our players, Jerry. Let's stop leaking out information, Jerry. That was the title of one of the articles. Jerry Jones mad at the player because he didn't get the jab. 20 years from now, we don't know what the ramifications of that jab will be. Right? And I'm not saying that people are wrong who got it. I'm not at liberty to tell you what to do with your body. But you shouldn't hold a player's feet to the fire about that. Right? That man had his decision, his choices. Don't hold that man's feet to the fire for that. Let him be. The man played chess, and the people take a hard time for people to beat him out there. You think that he don't know other things that he's smart and akin to, and akin to far as his mind and mental complex? Let's stop rushing to one side. Seeing people that say, hey, let's pray for the Ukraine. Pray for the Russians too. You think that everybody out there want to go into war because of one D dictator of one person that president is over everything? No. Bloodshed, both blood, we're gonna be red. So let's get out of the business of picking sides. Come on, Cowboy Nation, we better than this. And everybody that's listening, we better than this. Let's stay focused. Let's stay rooted in. I feel you, though. I'm rooting for Dan Quinn defense. The key to victory is Sugar Daddy won. Man, defense can change a lot, baby. It can. We got this defense. As angry and as upset how you guys been on this offensive side, I can tell you, we may not be the 2000 Ravens. Was it 2000? Was it 2000 Buccaneers? Was it 2000 Buccaneers and 2001 Ravens? I could have it mixed up. We may not be that team, but dog it, we can get close to it. Parsons is an animal. Build around that. Don't let us go get Jordan Davis. Woo! That boy, he run fast. Was it 4.78? Big boy. Pushing big body, can't stop me. Don't end up in letting us get a playmaker that can match up with Parsons. Shoot. It's fantasy talk now, but it can be real, baby. That defense can really shut some stuff down. It really can. Gallerick guard, appreciate you, says Prescott overplayed, no payoffs. 9-8. I like that. Because if we 9-8 and we still get to the playoff, that means we're hungry. Right? I mean, we got the PhD mentality, poor, hungry, and determined. The number one seed, it's hard for them to win the Super Bowl. If you think I'm lying, ask Green Bay. If you think I'm lying, ask the 2007 Dallas Cowboys. Number one seed, I believe. And the Giants snuck off into the playoffs. And they was hungry. They was determined. And I tell people all the time, a determined person with a shovel can dig a ditch faster than a lazy man can with a crane. You see, you put that message out there to be negative. I flipped it to be positive. Y'all can't stop the nation, baby. Let's continue to grind and shine, baby. Y'all write that down. Let's be positive, baby. Let's go. Let's roll credits. Appreciate y'all for jumping in for this episode. We up out of here. Salute. Let's go. Appreciate everybody for support. Yo. Nowadays, nothing really excites me. Only one of me and nobody's like me. Phone ringing and I tell him it's ice. I got wifey on blink. Shout out to your iceberg. Kill. Please, no photos. No, no. Jeez. No, no. Shout out to you, Blake. Please, no photos. Hit the door and the dome and just whole team here. Money some. Still young, but I'm a little. I meant every word I said, too, Cowboy Nation. If it down, let's go. I'm just warming up a way to lie. Old producer saw the numbers one. Different colors in my baggy light. Chalk it up, talk of the time when you're talking up. Wanna get you a ring and you tough enough. Wanna get you new things when your pockets dull. Run it up, I used to be quiet and out of luck. Now I move up and move humble cuz that hate and the jealousy, my mama telling me count up your blessings and run it up. Nowadays nothing really excites me. Only one of me and nobody's like me. Phone ringing and I tell him it's ice. I got wifey on bling and she icy. Freeze, photo, please, no photos, no, no. Jeez. No, 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 please, no photos. I keep giving game away. Long. I put game on layaway. Nation. I got paid to play today. Come on. I get paid to stay away. Come on. I get paid on rainy days. Yo. I might make it rain today. I got paid off pain today. Thought it'd take the the pain. Oh, final word tomorrow gonna be off the chain. I would never sell my only soul. Heard your whole team was for sale. Heard it's on the market for the low. Who the realest we might never know. Come on, baby. All this acting, you gon' play a role. Give you the world when they sign you up. Killer Death. You out and then they line you up. Appreciate you, Mel. Appreciate you. Hungry ribs are touching, need some food. Harold Jones. Appreciate you. Surprise, but you was fooled. Boy, get out the way. It's been a day. Now you're old news. Now you got the pen and pad. You're trying to take my moves. Now shout out to all of the underground YouTubers. Shout out to y'all. Man, we independent, man. Appreciate you. Appreciate the independent undergrounders, the content creators who can spit their mind and not a mouthpiece for someone else. Pull your strap on, man. You better kill me. My fofo, make sure all your kids don't grow, huh? Better be careful who you dealing with. Huh? Who you believe in? Yeah.
If you don't read the newspaper, you're uninformed. If you do read it, you're misinformed.
What do you do?
That's a great question. What is the long-term effect of too much information? One of the
effects
is to be first, not even to be true anymore. So what a responsibility you all have. Tell the truth, not just to be first.
Yeah, let's go.
Want the truth, you can't.